I am supposed to take 1 hour of psychrometry, and we will look at it mostly from, you know, the point of view that you already, or at least I would say that you should, as far as possible, try to emphasize that at least in this part of the course, if you are teaching students, that you should have the students practice psychrometry through the steam tables, rather than, you know, telling them to go to a psychrometric chart. So once they are confident with the steam tables and they know that the psychrometric chart is usually drawn, I mean normally at 1 atmospheric pressure, then they know that, you know, they can always come back to steam tables and do whatever calculations if the ambient atmospheric pressure is not 1 atmosphere. Okay, because if you go to a hill station, okay, for every around 1000 or 2000 meters in height, you know, the pressure drops significantly, you know, close to 10-15%, and then no longer your psychrometric charts, you know, as they are right now, can be applied, and you will need a psychrometric chart which is, you know, made for that pressure. So it's better if you just go for steam tables, at least in this course, and then if necessary, I'm sure that if the students will take a class on refrigeration and air conditioning, they will, you know, be very well versed with the psychrometric chart. I think that should be the overall, you know, guiding principle when you talk to them about psychrometry, if it is going to be a part of thermodynamics. So let me just begin and go over things fast. So I mean, normally if you know, we begin psychrometry, again a standard way to start is you go for the TS diagram of the water substance and draw a typical pressure line, okay, and then you can tell the students that, you know, as far as normal air is concerned, it is just not absolutely dry, and maybe only in, you know, very much in the interior of the country the weather is reasonably dry, but you know, close to the coast there is a lot of moisture, and they know what moisture means, you know, and that they sweat mostly a lot of it because of moisture, and you can tell that the state of air, water inside or in the surrounding air is basically its vapor, and once it's vapor, it means it's a kind of superheated liquid, a superheated state of water. And if you try to plot it on a TS diagram, it would be somewhere here, the state, and then you can tell them that this pressure line which on which probably it is lying is a very very small pressure, I mean, or a pressure which is of very less quantity, I mean compared to 1 atmosphere, this, the value of this pressure is pretty negligible, and this is the pressure at which water vapor is existing in the atmosphere. As if you draw this, then I think a lot of things become very clear, and you know, after this I don't think there is too much, if you just continue with this diagram, there is not too much that we can, you know, go wrong by when you are teaching psychrometry. So I'll just draw this pressure line on which water vapor is existing, and this is, let us call this line as PV, where V represents the or some kind of subscript for vapor. So this is how we begin with telling where the state of water vapor is, and once you say this, you say that now the pressure is so less that if you mix this with regular dry air, the dry air at 1 atmosphere reasonably behaves like an ideal gas, and water vapor in superheated state and at such low pressures also can be reasonably approximated as an ideal gas. Okay, and if this is again emphasized, then you realize that they can be told that water vapor will follow, as long as it is in the vapor state, most of the properties of ideal gas. Then only between steam tables and ideal gas relationships you can derive a lot of psychrometry, and you know, hopefully that should be good enough as a part of this course. So if we begin by saying that the water vapor pressure is PV, then we say the net pressure at any location is P, let us say it is P total, okay, that is made up of pressure of dry air plus PV. Okay. So, at any point this PT is the total atmospheric pressure or the barometric pressure, and this is made up of let us say two components. And here probably you can, you know, tell them about things that they have learned in chemistry, that is Dalton's law of partial pressures. So, if you have many gases which do not react, okay, and if they are mixed and if they are all behaving ideally, okay, then you know they will exert pressures in, you know, proportion to how many molecules are there of that gas, and that is what is, you know, the Dalton's law of partial pressures. And this is what will happen, that I can just then add the pressures of the two components and say that is the total pressure. So, this is, if you emphasize this, I mean that would be good enough, and then you can just come back and, you know, write down ideal gas relationships for each of these. Okay, if you had written them in terms of molar or in terms of moles, then I would have said number of moles of dry air times, so let me just write this, times universal gas constant times the ambient temperature divided by some volume that we are considering. So, this is this. This is number of moles of vapor multiplied by ideal gas constant divided by same volume. So, this is using the ideal gas law, PV is equal to nRT. And I could write it in terms of mass basis, where I would say that this is in a particular volume, okay, mass of dry air times specific gas constant for dry air. So, this is capital V, it is not specific volume. So, once this is set up, then what you can of course tell them is that, and they should know this, that for any gas the specific constant is just the universal gas constant divided by the molecular weight. So, at this point if you have already taught them combustion, or if they know about mole mass ratios, then you can go ahead and, you know, roughly you can derive what the molecular weight of dry air would be. And this is mostly based on telling them that, you know, dry air is mostly made up of nitrogen and oxygen, and though there are small components of other species, these are negligible, and just considering nitrogen and oxygen, you can derive roughly that the molecular weight of dry air is around 29, it is 28 point something, but you can put it as 29. And for water it is, you know, it is just H2O, so it is just above 18, but writing 18 is good enough. And if you can, if they would of course know all this because of their background in chemistry, and at this point, you know, it is just okay to re-emphasize what the specific gas constants would be for water and air. So, once this is done, so this of course would here be mass of total air, R of, you know, total moist air, let me call it MA, T upon volume. So, once this set is done, I think we can then, it is just okay to go ahead with telling them of the various terminologies in psychrometry. Okay, so, the first terminology that they should be aware of is something called okay, and it is always good to just stick. I mean, a lot of times, I mean, I am sure if you have taught this, you must have taught, a lot of times I see that students just remember some kind of a formula for specific humidity using 0.01 0.62, something like this. Okay, so if we just stick to the saying that specific humidity is just, if you take a particular volume, then the mass of water vapor or mv upon mass of air, that is the definition for specific humidity. Okay, then I think a lot of things, if they remember only this, then that is good enough. And if I just use now ideal gas law, I can go ahead and write it in terms of partial pressure. So now, you know, I know that PV is equal to MVRU/MVT, and I will just write MV is PV/RV/MT. So if I just substitute here, this would be PV/V/RV/MT, and for mass of air, it would just be, for this mass of dry air, I should write, it would be PV/RU/MT. So this T goes off, the V goes off, the RU goes off, and I am just left with MV/MA/PV/PA. And this is 18 upon roughly 29 PV/PA would be roughly 0.62. PV/PA. So, I am sure all of you remember this relationship, but rather than students remembering such a relationship, it is okay if they remember, you know, just the basic definition of what specific humidity means. Okay, and then as long as they remember that they have to use steam tables and ideal gas relationships, they cannot go wrong. I mean, everyone would know roughly what is the mass or molecular weight for water, what is the molecular weight for air. So, you know, getting this 18 upon 29 is not going to be that difficult at all for people, and what it should be. And once they get the number, they will obviously remember. But rather than trying to remember this as some formula, you know, it is always good to just tell them to remember that it is just a ratio of masses, and that is good enough. Of course, people sometimes write this as 0.62. PV/PA is just 0.62 PV/P total minus PV. Okay. This is another way people write this, because the pressure in air, we already discussed Dalton's law, we discussed that the two pressures add up to the total pressure, and hence the pressure of air is just the total pressure minus the vapor pressure. But I would say that, you know, if the emphasis is on ideal gas law and just the pure definition, you know, it just takes 1 minute to come up to this formula, and there is no need to remember anything more than that. The next concept that is normally taught is what is called as the dew point temperature. At this point, it is again best to go to the TS diagram. And remind them that this is where the state of water vapor is. It is lying on a particular pressure line, okay, that is at PV, okay, it is a very small value. And this is where the water vapor is in. So, if at the same pressure the water is just cooled down, or sorry, the air is just cooled down, then this is, of course, you know, this is where the temperature is right now. Okay. And at this point, you can tell them that, okay, this is the temperature of both the water vapor as well as air. And this is something which is normally measured with a thermometer, and this is what is normally called as the regular temperature or the dry bulb temperature. So this is where things are as they are existing, and if you start cooling the water vapor or the air down, then the pressure is the same, but the temperature starts going down, and this is how normally dew points are measured. You know, you keep a vessel and you start cooling it down slowly and see when condensation occurs. So this is what is occurring here, that at the same pressure, as I start cooling down, the temperature starts decreasing, and I just move along the same pressure line like this till I reach some point here where, you know, the water is just become saturated, okay, and it will start condensing out, and this temperature is just the saturation temperature corresponding to P. It's pretty straightforward that I drew a curve like this, and this is the existing temperature, which is much more than the saturation temperature. That is why it is in superheated state, and once I start cooling it down, obviously at some point I am going to reach the saturation temperature, and the saturation temperature is nothing but the dew point temperature for that PV. So if I had a different PV, I would have had a different, you know, dew point temperature. And of course, now at this point you can tell them that they should take out their steam tables and realize that, you know, for most of the low pressures the saturation temperature is given. So if they have the steam tables, knowing PV, you can immediately get what the dew point temperature. And at this point you can draw various PV curves like this. So at, if I draw a higher pressure line here, then let us say this is PV2, then obviously this pressure is more. If this pressure is more, then here the specific humidity is more because PV is higher, okay. And if I go along this pressure line, then the dew point temperature is definitely going to be a higher value. So the more the moisture in the air, the higher the dew point temperature will be, until you get up to this line here, where, you know, maybe the air is completely saturated with, you know, water vapor. At this point, completely the dew point temperature is the same as the existing dry bulb temperature. So if you draw via this diagram, I mean the concept of what a dew point temperature is, you know, they don't really have to, you know, think too much if they have the TS diagram of water pretty much clear in their head. So various pressures, various dew point temperatures till you reach this, and obviously beyond this you can't put in water into the air because it will just start condensing out. So you can tell them this is the maximum capacity of what the air can contain. So beyond this, at a particular temperature, I can't put in more water vapor than this vapor pressure. If I want to go higher, then I need a higher temperature. So I'll need to heat the water or heat the air and then put in, try to make it, you know, gather more air, because now I can go to a higher vapor pressure here. So if this concept is also told to them, that beyond a particular vapor pressure, you can't just push in water into the air because it will start condensing out. So I think that is something that can be well explained just by using a TS diagram.
All the points on the saturation vapor line,
yes,
are the dew point temperature.
Yes. So depending on what you are, so if I draw this, I mean which pressure? No. So if there is a particular vapor pressure, then there is a particular dew point temperature corresponding to it. So if the air was more moist, the vapor pressure would have been higher and the dew point temperature would also have been higher, because so this is, let's say, PV1, this is PV2. So if the air is relatively dry, then there is lesser water vapor in it and it corresponds to this lower pressure line, okay. And let us say this is the dry bulb temperature, okay. So this is the existing temperature at any place. Is that clear? And then if I am on this pressure line, then to get to the dew point temperature, I have to cool down till I reach the saturation temperature corresponding to this pressure line, and obviously this temperature is low compared. If I have a higher pressure, let us say I am existing here, definitely the, you know, specific humidity is higher in the air. I come down till I reach the saturation temperature corresponding to this pressure. Obviously, this temperature T2 is greater than T1, this is the T, you know, this is the T axis. So the higher the water vapor, if the overall pressure is the same, it does not matter, this water vapor pressure is what matters, and as long as you reach the saturation temperature corresponding to the vapor pressure, you have reached the dew point. Okay, so the air pressure could have been anything, it did not matter really, it was all depending on the saturation temperature corresponding to the vapor pressure. See, the total, see, this is what is assumed. Normally the total pressure is rarely assumed to change. Okay, that is because overall the pressure is around 1 atmosphere, people believe that PV is so negligible that overall P does not change, it does not really matter. And in general, if something changes, there is enough, you know, pressure, small pressure differences to just create a small flow, that overall pressure would not change. But that is not of concern here, it would not change the dew point temperature. Of course, what will happen is, let us say that I come here and I start condensing things out, then, you know, I can start condensing things out, and then I would have to move along the saturation line and keep on condensing. If let us say you keep a body which is at a temperature below T1, then first initially the air will come up to T1 and then it will start going below T1 and you will start condensing out all water. So you would move down in PV and PW, and let us say I remove all the water and keep it separately and still the air is there, and I bring it back to the older temperature, obviously I would have gone to an even lower line here, and if I bring it back. So my PV, you know, star would be even lower than PV1, because I would have removed all the water. I mean, that is pretty straightforward. I would have made it even more drier. In fact, this is a reasonable way of thinking what happens in an air conditioner. You just put it over cool coils, remove the water, and now it has become even drier. So you have actually moved to a lower PV line. That is exactly what you have done in air conditioner. Which one? Yes. See, if the regular atmospheric pressure is the same, then higher PV would have meant higher water vapor pressure, or more moisture, or more RH. We will come to RH.
The right side of the bell curve.
Yes.
The line will completely the saturated vapor line, isn't it?
Yes. This is the saturated.
Saturated,
yes.
Vapor line.
Yes.
X is equal to 1. That is dryness fraction is,
yes,
equal to 1.
Yes, yes.
Here X is equal to 0.
Correct.
So, particularly on the dryness fraction line, sorry, x equal to 1 saturated line,
yes,
the point is 100% saturated.
Correct.
Dry.
Yes, yes.
Vapor is 100% saturated.
Yes.
Dry. But in the definition of dew point temperature, what you have studied is the temperature of when which the first droplet of water begins to condense.
Correct.
Just 100% dry temperature may be taken as dew point temperature, sir. How?
Yes. So, unless the temperature has reached the saturation temperature, you cannot condense out. Finally, this is the same temperature line, is not it? This is completely saturated liquid, this is completely saturated vapor. Once it reaches here, only then you can achieve this state. Okay. So, that is the same temperature. So, finally, it has to be the same dew point temperature. It is the saturation temperature corresponding. Yes, for this vapor pressure, this is the boiling temperature, that is for sure. So, if the pressure was reduced so much, that is where it would have boiled. So, it is already superheated, it is beyond boiling. So, the next concept is what is called as degree of saturation. So again, you draw the TS diagram. So now this is addressing that other question. So this is where we are. This is the vapor pressure line on which we exist. Okay, and this is the dry bulb temperature, the temperature of the surrounding. Okay, and here is water vapor in superheated state. So, as I said, you know, you can have different pressure lines here. So, this would mean more moisture. So, at any point, okay, if let us say you are here, obviously the air can take more moisture, it is available that you can put in more moisture into the air. So, you can actually put in steam and try to increase the moisture of air, and a lot of time this is done. So, I mean it is not done probably, at least in Mumbai it is not done, but in wherever in air conditioning in the US etcetera, where it is very dry weather, you know, if you just try to cool an existing heat an existing atmosphere in dry conditions, so it gets very cold in the winter, and if I just put a room heater, all you have done is just heated the room, it is already dry, and you will feel your skin really not able to take this kind of dry weather. At that time people would actually start pushing in moisture by, you know, pumping in steam into the air, and it is necessary because your skin can't take it otherwise, it becomes too dry. So, that means at any point if things are dry, I can still go on putting more and more moisture into the air. So, at that point if I put more moisture, obviously the vapor pressure is going to increase. So, I will now move from this vapor pressure to this vapor pressure at the same temperature. Okay. Obviously, I can heat and increase, I could have moved up also, but let us assume that I can move at the same temperature to a higher vapor pressure line. So, I can go on and on and on till I reach here. So, you can go on doing this till you reach this point, and at this point you are saturated. Again you can't put in more water vapor because it will start condensing out, the air cannot take it. So, this obviously is the saturated condition. Corresponding to the DBT, to the dry bulb temperature. Okay. So, this is an unsaturated condition here, this is an unsaturated condition, this is an unsaturated condition, I move through various unsaturated conditions till I reach a saturated condition. Okay. So, every time I am trying to keep the temperature same and pump in more and more water vapor to increase the moisture content in the air till I reach saturation. Obviously, here I will have some omega 1, that is specific humidity, I will have some omega, sorry I have called this PV 2, some omega 2 which is higher specific humidity. Finally, I reach here, I will get some other omega, which let me call it as omega saturated. So, at a particular temperature, I will have a vapor pressure which corresponds to the saturation vapor pressure corresponding to that temperature. So, there is two concepts. So, one is the saturation temperature corresponding to, you know, the current pressure, that will lead me to what is called as the dew point temperature, and there is a saturation pressure corresponding to this temperature. So, this vapor pressure line goes like this here. So, I have moved along different vapor pressure lines till I reach here. So, this is the saturation pressure corresponding to the current temperature. So, this is another. So, corresponding to this, I will call this as PS. This is saturation pressure corresponding to T. Obviously, corresponding to this PS, there would be a WS. The WS would have been just, of course, now I am writing the formula, but you know, PS upon P minus PS. Okay. So, there is something called a degree of saturation. Is just omega existing upon omega s, as far as I know they should be there. This is what is called as a degree of saturation. Obviously, if you are, if you have reached the saturation pressure, your degree of saturation is 1, you cannot increase it, otherwise omega will be always less than omega s, your degree of saturation would be less than 1. So, there is a saturation temperature corresponding to the current vapor pressure, that is dew point temperature, there is a saturation pressure corresponding to the current temperature, which is the saturation pressure, which is normally I will call it as PS, and corresponding to that I will get an omega S, the specific humidity, and the ratio of the specific humidities again is the definition, degree of saturation, just ratio of specific humidities current to the saturated one. The saturated one is at the saturated pressure. So, most of these definitions are just going to be ratios. So, the next definition is again a ratio, and it is a very commonly used parameter, it is relative humidity. So, this is just defined as if I take a particular volume, then what is the mass of water vapor right now upon what will be the mass of water vapor in the saturated state, again corresponding to that saturation pressure. Okay. Now, if I take put the ideal gas law here, okay, so we had that Cv is equal to mRv. So, and then Ps, obviously if I take at the same volume, this is what I am doing, if I take a ratio here, this is Rv is same, at the same temperature I am getting the saturation pressure. So, obviously Mv upon Mvs is just going to be Pv upon Pvs, and normally people will use this for the definition of relative humidity. This is going to be a ratio which is less than 1, but a lot of times people express it as a percentage. So, expressed commonly as a percentage. So, RH would be just PV upon PVS multiplied by 100. So, I mean again just to emphasize, this is your PV, you are here, this is PV, this is PVS, you have moved along this till you reach here. RH is just the ratio of this pressure to this pressure multiplied by 100. So, finally, we are just talking of either the saturation temperature corresponding to a pressure or the saturation pressure corresponding to the current temperature. So, between these two, most of our definitions are done. I mean, whether it is the dew point temperature, whether it is degree of saturation, or whether it is relative humidity. And definitely, the relative humidity is going to turn out to be a number less than 1. If I multiply it by 100, then it will be a number less than 100. And you can say if it is very close to 100, relative humidity is very high. That means I am at a line which is very, very close to saturation, and hence you will feel that the moisture is very, very, it is very, very, you know, humid. Whereas if I move farther and farther away, it is going to be very, very dry. So, between, you know, I just by this diagram, it is good enough. They know that all of these quantities can be just, you know, calculated using the steam table. You pick up the steam table, go to the current temperature in the room, see what the saturation pressure is, you will know immediately how to calculate the relative humidity. Or for the current vapor pressure, get the saturation temperature, you will know what the dew point temperature is. So, that is okay.
Isn't it more easy to express in terms of specific humidity?
So, I mean, you will have to justify, why do you say that?
Hey, because again, it is a ratio of pressure as such, what we said. But when I say that quantity of moisture divided by quantity of air, isn't it more easy?
So, okay, let me try to see why you are doing this. See, whenever I am or, you know, going to do calculations regarding mixing of air, at that time the specific humidity is going to be the far more easy quantity to deal with. That is because when I do calculations regarding moist air, I will take everything in terms of per kg of dry air, in which case how much quantity of moisture is there per kg of dry air, it becomes very easy to me. I take one stream of 2 kg of dry air with so much omega, that is specific humidity, another 1 kg is another omega 2. If I mix them, I know what is the water here, I know what is the water here, I can just add them because I know it in terms of per dry air basis. So at that time, for such calculations, it's very easy to deal with. But if you just tell me the omega specific humidity just like that, people don't know how far away from saturation I am. So as far as weather and atmosphere and how much humid I am feeling, that omega number is not going to give me a feeling. Whereas a number between 0 and 100 gives me a good feel of it. You know, oh, 100 means it's really humid. So to tell the weather relative humidity is definitely the way, you know, the quantity to use. But if you are going to do calculations using for mixing of moist air, if relative humidity has been given, immediately calculate the omega, because all calculations are best done with omega if you are doing mixing calculation. Otherwise, to tell the weather, I think relative humidity is really one of the best ways to tell how far away or how humid you are feeling. So, you know, we have done various concepts here, and then finally there is what is called as a wet bulb temperature. And again, this is a concept that is used often, and you would see that in psychrometric, or in whenever people are describing psychrometry, they will tell you what is normally called as the wet bulb temperature, and there is another quantity which they would define normally as an adiabatic wet bulb temperature. Because the regular wet bulb temperature is defined in terms of just some heat transfer coefficients and mass transfer coefficient, and they would not involve thermodynamics in it, and hence they will say this is a regular wet bulb temperature. And what it is that if I have a regular thermometer, so this is so let me draw the TS diagram again to see what is happening. So here we are at a particular PV, now what I can do is this air, I can, you know, out of this air, I can start reducing, let us say, the temperature. And one way that normally happens, and if you have been in dry weather, you know that there is something called as this cooler, you know. So, you have this fan with some curtain of air in front of it, and it blows air. It will work in dry weather. That is because what you are doing is you are essentially pushing in water into the air. Air is reasonably dry. Okay, once you start putting in water, okay, if and the vapor pressure is pretty low, once you put in less quantity of water, the water will use up energy from the air to dry up. Okay, and it will become water vapor. So as it is using up, you know, water vapor, energy to dry, the temperature of the air will drop down because it has lost energy in, you know, converting this water into vapor, and that is why you will start feeling cool. So this is the regular, you know, cooler that you know of. Obviously, such coolers will not work in humid weather because already things are pretty humid, and you want to put in more water into the air. You know, people are already feeling sticky, you will start feeling stickier, and that is not going to help too much. Whereas, if I have, let us say, this temperature, this thermometer, and if I, you know, surround it, or, you know, put one, let me change the color here. So, if I surround it with some kind of a wet cloth, and push air on it, then what is going to happen is, if you know the state of air is somewhere here, obviously it can take more moisture in. And what it does normally is that if I push it over some wet cloth or wet region, I mean that is completely saturated, and normally that would have been saturated at the dry bulb temperature, okay, just before I begin anything. Now once I start pushing air, though it will know that okay, there is water here, so it will start absorbing water from this wick, and some water will get into the air. So what happens is that you move to a higher vapor pressure line here, because you have put in more water vapor. But to vaporize the water, because water in this cloth was in water form, so you are going to vaporize it if it has to mix with the water. So what it does, it picks up some amount of energy from the air itself and some amount from the cloth, and the cloth temperature drops down and the air temperature also drops down, okay. So that means that I no longer I am going to be at this temperature, this is my dry bulb temperature. I would have moved to a higher vapor pressure line, but at a lower temperature, because now the air has lost energy, its temperature is going down. So I will move like this. So I will move in essence between this line and this line. So everything basically happens within this. One is the saturation, pressure, it's this line here, it's just the extension of the saturation pressure line at constant temperature, and this is the same pressure line, okay. So I will move to a higher vapor pressure, so I will move to one of these lines in between, there are so many lines in between till I reach saturation. I will move to a higher vapor pressure line, but at a lower temperature, and this will keep on continuing, okay. I can go on moving till I reach, so I will go on, the temperature will keep on reducing and the vapor pressure will keep on increasing, till of course, once I reach here, I can't cross this barrier, because now I have reached a saturated state. But at this point, you have reached a lower temperature and you have reached a saturated state corresponding to that lower temperature, okay. And this point normally would have been called what is the wet bulb temperature. Okay. And if equilibrium is reached, then the temperature of this wick here, okay, this green cloth that I have drawn, is the same as the temperature that this air will achieve once it has passed over it, okay. So that means initially I will start going down, and as the air starts passing over the wick temperature also will drop, the air temperature also will drop, and now I have reached a temperature which corresponds to this, okay. So this, that means at this point no longer the wick temperature is going to go down, because the air temperature also, it can't go lower than the air temperature at this point. So what is actually happening is that once you have reached some kind of steady state, all the energy that is required to vaporize the water from this wick is actually coming from this air, and you have just a balance between how much energy is required to vaporize the water vapor is entirely coming in as the energy to go from the dry bulb temperature to the wet. So that is what is happening in this whole process, and you reach this wet bulb temperature. So now you can show that this is a pretty unique point, but this is not thermodynamic in nature. You have just used heat transfer to do this, and there are various empirical relations available to have a relationship between, because this will obviously depend on the vapor pressure you are right now. If you are at a different vapor pressure, you will have a different wet bulb temperature. And obviously, if you are at a vapor pressure here, you are already at the wet bulb temperature. So if you are completely saturated, you can no longer go down to a lower temperature or a higher vapor pressure line. So when you are completely saturated, your wet bulb and dry bulb temperature are same. Otherwise, depending on the current temperature and current vapor pressure, there will be a wet bulb temperature, and there are empirical relationships, okay. And I have not copied any one of them here, but one of the famous equations is what is called as a carrier equation, which relates the wet bulb temperature, okay, to PV and the dry bulb temperature. Okay. So again, if you show this on the TS diagram, people will have a good idea and they will know between what limits you are operating overall. Okay, the dry dew point temperature, the saturation pressure, and the vector. Once this is done, you can probably tell them a brief about the psychrometric chart. Okay, the psychrometric chart is normally, you know, drawn with dry bulb temperature here and omega here. Okay. Overall, you realize that if I knew the temperature, the total pressure and PV, I can get omega, correct, because it is just going to be PV upon PT minus PV. I can get, take the steam tables, get PS, and if I know PS using the steam tables, I can get PV upon PS and say this is RH. I can use the steam tables and get the dew point temperature. Okay. So, basically if I know these three quantities, I know all my other quantity, and of course, even degree of saturation, which is again ratio of omegas at PV and PS. So, that is, conversely, if I know, let us say, PT and T, and I am always going to use PT and T because you will always have a pressure gauge and a temperature to measure ambient temperature and pressure, and these are two are the most common quantities people will give you. You realize that you require only a third quantity. I will require PV, or let us say someone did not know PV, but they knew that I can take a vessel, keep on cooling it and see when, you know, dew starts forming on it. I know that is the dew point temperature. If I know the dew point temperature, I know that it is the temperature which corresponds to the saturation temperature of PV. So, if I know the dew point temperature, I know PV immediately, because I just have to go to the steam table, figure out at the dew point temperature what is the saturation pressure, correct. So, I will just go here. I do not know what PV is, but I know what this temperature is. I know what this temperature is, I know what this temperature is, but I just go to the steam table, find out what is the saturation vapor pressure corresponding to this temperature. This better be this one. So, the moment I know PV, you know that I can solve everything else. Similarly, you know, if I know RH, that is also good enough, because if I know the temperature, I know what is the saturation pressure. So, you just go to the steam tables, get saturation pressure corresponding to dBT. So, I know that is this line. So, if I know RH is just PV upon PS. So, PV is just RH into PS. Obviously, I will put this as a fraction less than 1, not express it as a percentage. So, I will get PV. Once I know PV, again I know all quantity. So, dry bulb temperature and, you know, the pressure are normally given. If I know what is PV, I can find out everything. I cannot normally get PV, but if you give me RH, that is slightly difficult to find, but always P, DPT is pretty easy to find out, and WBT is also pretty easy to find out. If I know WBT, I can get using the carrier equation what is PV, and then I can go ahead. So, knowing these two quantities and PV is good enough, and to get PV, either I should know dew point temperature or I should know wet bulb temperature, and that is good enough. I will get all other quantities required for what I want. And then I can go and draw this psychrometric chart. This is W, this is dBT. So, obviously, if I look again at this TS diagram, I take a particular temperature here. This is T, this is S. I take a particular temperature. So, I will know that I can get an omega here. I can get an omega here, I can get an omega here, and I get an omega which corresponds to this, which is the saturation omega, correct. So, for every temperature with the, I can get a saturation omega, correct. If I go to a higher temperature, obviously this PV is a higher one and I get a higher saturation omega, So, if I know a temperature, I can get a saturation omega. And this is, let us say, this is increasing temperature, this is increasing W. If I have a higher temperature, I have a higher saturation omega. So, I will have this various saturation omegas and I will just draw a curve like this through them. And since this is the curve corresponding to saturation omegas, it is the curve corresponding to when it is saturated at that temperature. So, it means it is the curve corresponding to 100% relative humidity. So, this is what would normally be called as the RH100 curve. Now, I can similarly draw an RH curve for different omegas, that is because different relative humidities. So, all I have to do is say, let me say relative humidity 90%. I will find out saturation, I will find out vapor pressure, take 0.9 times of it. Take calculate omega at 90% relative 90% of saturation pressure and connect all the points, I will get a 90% RH. And hence I can draw various curves. And these are what is that? Yeah, sorry, I mean I have drawn things here, I am sorry, it will always start from the end here, correct. When I put RH and omega and T, so there is one more quantity which is very important when you come to air conditioning and which normally people will use, we will put H here. And this is because whenever you are doing all kinds of mixing calculations, the enthalpy will by default come in, it is an open system process, you mix things. Okay. So, the H calculation is something which people often do and they will put it on that curve, H, various H curve. And what you have to know is that you will just say that you take 1 kg of dry air. If you know the state of the air, you know what is omega. So, for 1 kg of dry air, you will have omega kg of water. And you just add the enthalpy of this and the enthalpy of this to get the total enthalpy. Now, the enthalpy of this, I can start, you know, 1 kg m Cp delta T, I can start put 0 somewhere. So, you already for all of these energies and enthalpies that some base you have to put. And you normally know, and in most engineering calculations with air and water, I will put the base at T is equal to 0 degree. At this, I will define the enthalpy of air as 0. So, here if I am just going to measure the enthalpy of air, the temperature is just greater than 0, I will just put it as Cp. Okay. Of course, things will change if you have sub-zero temperatures and then you will just write it in terms of negative enthalpy or shift your base somewhere else, it does not matter. So, it is up to you. Normally, we will talk about positive temperatures, that is above 0, you will put Cpt for your enthalpy of air. Similarly, if I have water vapor, I know it is here, and at this point you can explain to people that here also I normally put the enthalpy 0 at saturated liquid condition at 0 degrees. This is a very common thing that people do. If I put 0 here, then if I want this enthalpy, obviously I will first have to go all the way here. This is just HFG and then I have reached vapor state. So, I will use whatever is Cp for vapor into this T. Minus 0. This is if I was going along the P corresponding to 0 degrees here and reach this temperature. Okay. If I move along another line here like this, okay, you can show that the specific enthalpy for all these points is not different. So, for example, I need to go, let us say, to this temperature along another pressure line. Okay. So, So there is a, this pressure line, okay, it has a different saturation temperature here, which is higher than 0 degrees. Okay, let's say it is 10 degrees. Okay, so now how do I get the enthalpy for this point? What I need to do is, first I take water at 0 degrees, I heat it up to 10. So first I have to Cw, that is C of water, 10 minus 0. So first I have heated the water up to 10 degrees. Then I need to convert it into vapor. So then I have to add HFG corresponding to 10 degrees, because HFG varies with the temperature. And then finally, I have to go from 10 degrees, let us say dry bulb temperature is 30 degrees. I need to go Cv 30 minus 10. And only if I add up all this, I would have gotten the correct enthalpy starting with the base correct. Okay. Or, you know, at this same temperature here, I have the saturation vapor pressure line, I can get directly the enthalpy edge from steam table. Now, you can tell students that they should do an exercise, take the steam table, take the 0 degree saturation vapor pressure line. Okay, here I am starting with H0 right here. This roughly corresponds to 2501, the HFG at 0 degrees, and I will have this enthalpy as 2501 plus Cv times T minus 0. I will have this enthalpy corresponding to this calculation, and I will have this enthalpy directly from the steam tables. It is the saturation enthalpy at. So, you can tell them to do all these calculations. Now, what happens is, roughly in this regime, since air, sorry, water vapor behaves like an ideal gas, you will realize that H in a very good approximation is a function of temperature only. It's not a function. So, whether I calculate using this method or this method or this method, as long as the temperature is same, your values of enthalpy should not be too much off. They will be off, because it is not really an ideal gas, but, and especially close to the vapor dome, it is not really an ideal gas. But you can still tell them to do this exercise and see that the specific enthalpy is same. And once they are convinced, then the easiest formula is to go for this, because you have to remember only two numbers. One is 2501, which is HFG at 0. Plus Cv times T, and this roughly people take as 1.88, and that is good enough. So, once they know how to calculate H, then all you have to do when you come here with this line here is that I can get, if I know the omega and a particular temperature, I can get the enthalpy, then I can join lines of same enthalpy and get equal enthalpy lines, and that is something that you do on normal.
Then enthalpy, this sign of enthalpy becomes negative.
Correct. So, I mean, it is up to you, whether you want to work with negative enthalpies, it is up to you.
But negative enthalpy is a stored energy, isn't it?
Yeah, you should not think of it like this. Okay. I mean, I think you have already seen enough of this curve. It just, you are measuring some kind of thermodynamic quantity from a base. If you want, you are free to shift the base to minus 100 degrees and do all calculations from there. So, that is your freedom. As long as you do it consistently, there is going to be no problem, because finally you will realize that I need to heat air from this to this, I just need the difference, that is all I need. So, and one thing which probably does not affect this course, but I have seen it affects lot of times in refrigeration courses, is some refrigeration courses, they will use this R12 and they have a particular base for entropy, and some other books have another base for entropy. And yeah, it is the most commonsensical way to look at it, isn't it? We are used to what is called as 0 degrees. It is just, you know, imbibed in our memory, okay, that 0 is some, you know, number which we figured out is where ice melts, and we have used. Yes. So, you do you want to use 273.15 is the question. It is up to you. See, the question, the thing here is, people always work in units which they are most comfortable with. And this is, you know, I am not the person who is making standards here, but you are right. If everyone decides that let us throw away Celsius and Fahrenheit scales and let us work only in Kelvin scale, probably it will be simpler, okay. And if you work only in Pascals,
it will be simpler. But even now you will see some people work only in bars, some people work only in torrs. Similarly, if you go to US, no one knows what Celsius means. They still talk in Fahrenheit. No, I mean, is that something that I have a hold on? I don't have a hold on.
Reference from the triple point?
No, it is in most of the engineering calculations, people put it as 0 degrees. So that is what is the most common, you know.
Yes.
Yeah, during rainy seasons,
yes,
when we switch on the air conditioning in cars, the drivable temperature comes down and no moisture formation. But when we are not switching on the AC, the drivable temperature actually increases,
yes,
but moisture is formed on the glass.
Yes. So this is the inside. So this is the inside of the car, isn't it? So definitely, when you are, you know, at this temperature, let us say, you are saying that you are at saturation. Basically, what you are doing is you are exhaling out water vapor, and most of that is going to go and, you know, condense out onto those screen. And when you are using an AC, you are actually drying out things, because you are, you know, condensing out the vapor elsewhere and putting in dry air. And that is why once you have dry air inside the car, anything which is vaporized will just get sucked into the air and it will vaporize, and then you are again condensing it out somewhere in the AC machine, and that is what is happening. So whenever you have dry air, any excess, so for example, you know, you know for sure that, let's say you leave out some amount of water in the room and overnight, and let's say it's fallen on the floor. Next day, if you come and see it's totally dry, you know, that the weather was dry, it just got sucked into it. So similarly, you ensure a dry atmosphere in using the AC, and you just suck out the moisture which has formed anywhere on the glass, and that is what.
The AC cools it down to much lower temperature.
Yes.
And is applied to the car at a higher temperature, whereby the relative humidity has come to a lower value, and hence that air can absorb.
Correct. Much
more.
So that's what I'm saying. The AC is supplying you dry air.
But I mean, what I'm trying to say is, on the cooling coils, it has reached saturation.
Yes.
But later it gets heated to a higher value as it comes into the inside of the car. So that's
okay.
Why the RH value lowers, and then able to.
Yes. So what you are of course saying is that, if there is a heater along with it, then it happens. No, see, not all ACs behave like this.
Without the heater itself, the relative humidity lowers because the inside car body temperature or whatever adds to the temperature.
Yes. So what you are saying is that you have actually removed the, you have cooled it and then heated it. Okay, then that's always possible, and that's the best solution in this case. But that's possible.